Okay, so this is the deep dive session for the Rook, open source Rook project. My name is Jared Watts, and I am one of the senior maintainers on the Rook project. I was part of the founding team of that project, so I've been on it since the very beginning when we open sourced it about 2 years ago. And I'm also a founding engineer of a startup company called Upbound that's based in Seattle, and we are hiring, so reach out to me. We're going to get some good engineers. All right, so I see more faces today at the deep dive than I did yesterday at the intro session. And I'm not sure if that's because everybody already knew about Rook and they didn't need the intro, but we're going to go through that real quick just in case to get everybody on the same page. And then we've got two different deep dives that we're going to do today. The first one is about the orchestration for Ceph. This distributed storage system known as Ceph, and that's the first storage system that Rook supported, and it's the most stable one. So we're going to walk through that deep dive there, and then we're also going to do a deep dive about how other storage solutions can integrate into Rook and what it takes, what kind of code you have to write. So this is going to be some of the topics are going to be a little bit more advanced today. But you know, we will have plenty of time at the end for questions. I'll sacrifice demo time in favor of question time. All right, so let's get through this quick. So Rook is a cloud-native storage orchestrator. And so what that means is that we've taken Kubernetes and we've extended it with new types, new custom controllers that handle specifically storage systems. So if you need persistent storage for your applications, Rook can do that heavy lifting, that work to bootstrap it, deploy it, configure it, manage it, upgrade it, scale it up, scale it down, all that work that an administrator would normally do manually. Rook has these software operators that do that for you automatically. So as I mentioned, we started off with only supporting Ceph. And since then, in the past 2 years, we've increased the scope of the Rook project to have support for other storage providers, other storage solutions as well. So Rook is now a framework for enabling different storage solutions to come inside Kubernetes. It's open source project, and it's also a Cloud Native Computing Foundation project. We entered as a sandbox project back in January, and then in September of this year, we graduated to the incubating stage. And that's why we've got flags and socks and everything around the conference now. The benefits of being an incubating project. All right, so let's talk about storage challenges in Kubernetes. People like to say that there's stateless apps, but when you get down to it, most everything needs to store state. You gotta have storage to do pretty much anything persistent, right? So what happens a lot of times is that in Kubernetes clusters, you'll be relying on storage that's external to the cluster. And so that requires that that service is somewhere that your Kubernetes cluster can access. Maybe if you're on a different Kubernetes cluster, you can't access that storage. And it also means that somebody has to go and set up the storage appliance or the external storage system. In the case of cloud provider services like EBS or Google Persistent Disk or some of the database products, every cloud provider has a bunch of storage products you can use. They're great, they're awesome, but if you start using one of them, it makes it very hard to move to a different cloud provider. And then also another thing is, once you deploy your storage, that's great on day one once it's set up, but on day two, somebody's got to manage this thing, right? So it's nice to have software to automate that for you. So some solutions to those problems is take advantage of Kubernetes. Kubernetes is so good now at managing the lifecycle and health of dynamic cloud-native applications. So what about if we bring storage into Kubernetes directly? Not through a plugin, but natively running storage inside Kubernetes. And let's build on that. Let's make some abstractions to cover all storage needs, not just file, block, and object storage. But what about databases, message queues, key value stores, caches, all those things? There's so many different types of storage. And what we need to do is bring them into Kubernetes so your apps can use them. And once you have a notion of portability of I need data, and wherever I'm going with my application to another Kubernetes cluster, if I can access my data still then you get to your app starts to get choose the best cost or the features or government compliance. You can choose other things besides just, I need my storage. You can put that in the back burner, start worrying about important things. And we already talked about automation. So two quick things to get into. We talked about this yesterday, but they're two key parts of how you make Kubernetes do new tricks. So the first one is what's called a custom resource definition, or a CRD is what we'll also refer to it as. But that's basically the way that you teach Kubernetes about new objects. So things like pods and config maps and secrets, those are all objects inside Kubernetes. But what if you want to make your own object, your own custom objects? You can do that with these CRDs. So you teach Kubernetes about new types of objects. And then they become first-class citizens. So on kube control, on the command line there, it'll know about these new objects that you taught it. So we use those extensively in Rook to teach Kubernetes about new storage systems. And then the other one is operators. So operators, you can think of those as automated software that handles the day-to-day tasks that a normal administrator would handle. So this is automated software that does it, and it does it with a three-step approach. First, the software will look at the cluster. It'll observe and see what's in the cluster currently. It'll analyze that state versus what needs to be in the cluster, what the user has said that they want. And then with that delta there, the difference between actual and desired, the operator, this automated software, will take steps to drive the actual state towards what the user desires. And then last thing here is Rook, as I said earlier, started with just supporting Ceph. And now it's got a few, maybe four or five or six operators now. But it's not just those operators and those custom resources. It's also a framework. So when you want to do if you want to take a storage system and bring it into Kubernetes, we've made that a lot easier with all these reusable types and specs and logic and testing. So I told this yesterday, but one I'm really excited about is that Cassandra. There's a grad student in Greece that is doing that as his thesis, and he's almost done with it. So you know, we got a university student to integrate Cassandra into Kubernetes in a very well done way too. It's fully automated, will handle scaling of the cluster, health management, other various management tasks. It's pretty awesome. All right, so let's get into Ceph. So how many people here have used Ceph as a distributed storage system before? Cool, fair amount of hands, okay, awesome. I don't know how many of you have experience with that before Rook, or if you've had manual experience with Ceph. But the first time I tried to set up a Ceph cluster before we wrote the Rook project, it didn't go well, I'll say that. There was a whole lot of commands that needed to get run, and when there were errors, I didn't really know what was going on. So let's talk about what Rook does specifically for Ceph every step of the way here. So the general approach, and this can be extended to most of the operators that Rook provides, but basically what happens here is that the Ceph operator inside Rook, it'll be running as a pod, and that pod will be sitting there waiting for the user to tell it what it wants. Like, I want a Ceph cluster with this much storage and this many monitors, etc. And so that Rook operator will use the Ceph tools, the Ceph binaries, to do the steps it takes to initialize and bootstrap the cluster, like set up all the authorization in the CephX users, create the default crush map, add object storage daemons into the crush map, do all that work using the Ceph tools. So that's one step. And another really important part here is that basically at the end of the day, what the operator is going to be doing is it's going to be generating Kubernetes primitives that represent the Ceph storage components. So it'll generate pod templates and wrapping controllers like deployments or replica sets, stateful sets, those sort of lifecycle management primitives that Kubernetes offers to get the Ceph configuration into a pod that is then, if it crashes, then the wrapping deployment will bring it back up and keep things healthy. And then lastly, the operator will over time monitor the cluster, make sure that none of the monitors have gone out of quorum, or placement groups need to be rebalanced or remapped. So this is the general approach that we'll see for basically all the Ceph components. So for the monitors are the first component that you in a Ceph cluster that you deploy, and they are incredibly important. They are they're aware of where everything in the cluster lives and kind of communicating and talking to all the other components in the cluster. So we have in the Ceph cluster resource, you can specify how you want these monitors to be deployed. So kind of in the vein of the general approach we were talking about before, the operator will create a pod for each monitor and then wrap that with the deployment object and then use some placement like anti-pod affinity and node affinity to make sure that each monitor ends up on a different node so you don't have two of them on the same node, which creates more common failure scenarios. And then lastly, it creates a Kubernetes service object so that each monitor has a consistent IP address, so that if the pod goes down and comes back up, it still has the same unique, consistent IP address that other components in the cluster know how to find it. And so what's something really interesting here, or another common theme, is that what's being done by the operator is a lot of work that's domain specific. It knows how Ceph works, but it's integrating with the Kubernetes API to turn those Ceph components into Kubernetes components that can then run in the Kubernetes cluster, like deployments and services, right? Let's see what time's okay. All right, so monitors, it's really, really important that that a pod can die and come back up, right? That's kind of what a big facet of cloud-native computing is to be able to kind of drive things more towards stateless and dynamic sort of scenarios. So when a monitor dies, it's storing all of its data locally in a host path volume, and on the local node that it was deployed to. So when it comes back up, it'll just rehydrate itself with that data that's stored locally. And then it will get itself back into quorum and make sure that everything's healthy. And if it's not, the operator will take over for that mon pod, make sure and clean up the deployment, clean up the pod, and replace it with a new one so that all the monitors get back into quorum again. And that's kind of what we're talking about here on this next slide, is that the operator is in charge over time of making sure that when monitors go out of quorum, that they will be replaced, or corrective actions will happen such that all the monitors will still stay healthy, stay talking to each other, and the cluster as a whole stays healthy. So OSDs are object storage daemons. These are the components in Ceph that actually store all the bytes in the system. So when you save a file or you write some bytes to a Ceph cluster, they're all going to end up on these object storage daemons. There's multiple, there could be hundreds or thousands of them all scattered around the cluster, and data will be segmented up and placed around the cluster in a balanced way across these object storage daemons. So for each one of these, the steps that it takes, was once again the same sort of approach here, right? Where it's going to be using Kubernetes primitives to take care of these Ceph-specific tasks. So it will schedule it uses a daemon set to, on every node in the cluster, we need to know what devices are there. Maybe this node has a couple SSD drives, maybe this other one has a couple spinning platter magnetic drives. We need to know what devices are in the cluster, so that we can create object storage daemons for each one of them. So we'd have a daemon set that runs on every node in the cluster that discovers that and reports that back to a config map that's stored locally that the operator can then make decisions about, okay, this node has this device and this node has this device, so I'll schedule out an OSD pod to run on those nodes and start consuming those raw disks. One new feature that's, I guess it's not that new, I wrote the code a few months ago, is horizontal scaling. So when you, let's say you plug a couple of more hard drives into your cluster or add a new node to the cluster, the Ceph operator will see that there's more devices available and it will schedule out OSDs to run on them as well. So basically it's kind of plug and play, where you add more disks and your cluster will grow in size as well. There's a couple different ways, you might need to move through this a little quicker. There's a couple different ways that you can specify what sort of devices you want to run. You can say that you want to use all the nodes and all the devices, and just, you know, everything Rook and Ceph finds, just start using it. There's some sanity checks to make sure that we're not going to format or, you know, take over a drive that's already in use or has a file system or has child partitions. But basically, it's, you know, carte blanche to just use everything it can find in the system. And then otherwise, you can specify more specifically about, okay, on this node, use this device or use a filter that, you know, a regular expression that you can use every device that matches this regex. So you can kind of get a little bit more fine-grained control about what disks you want to be included. So there's other components in Ceph. So the cool thing about Ceph is that it's block storage, file storage, and object storage, all three of them in one single distributed storage solution, right? So RGW is the RADOS gateway, which is basically the object storage over internet, like the S3 storage, basically, object storage. And I think we can kind of skip through some of these details. So the slides are available online on the KubeCon schedule site. But basically what this what happens here is that, you know, each when you want an object store for Ceph, then the Ceph operator will see that you've created an object store CRD. It'll create all the storage pools that are needed in Ceph to back that object storage. And then it'll start up all these RGW pods with deployments to make sure that they're reliable, that they're, you know, highly available, and then put some service, Kubernetes services, in front of them so that clients can access them. So this is just yet again another example of take a Ceph concept, the operator sees that the user wants that Ceph thing object, and then it translates it into a bunch of Kubernetes objects that are running and managed by Kubernetes to keep things healthy and running. Same, very similar thing for CephFS, the shared file system from Ceph. Exact same pattern that we saw for RGW, so we can kind of skip over that. And then here's here's the kind of one of the last things to get to talk about Ceph. So we showed in the demo yesterday, if you were here, I showed a MySQL pod that was backing storage for WordPress. And they were both using volumes, dynamic volumes, provisioned by Rook and Ceph RBD, Rados Block Device. And I showed you that when you kill MySQL, magically it'll, you know, move over to another pod and have the same data and the website still up, right? So the way that that happens is the Rook agent. So the Rook agent is running on each node in the cluster, and it does all that local work for when a pod gets scheduled to a local node. Then the Rook agent will say, okay, I'm here, I'm ready. You need a volume, how big? Okay, I'll create a virtual block device within the cluster and then map it to a local RBD device on that node, format it if it needs to, and then mount a file system on top of it such that the pod can then start writing it. When that pod gets scheduled somewhere else in the cluster, or we kill it manually like I did yesterday, and the pod gets moved somewhere else, the reverse happens where that Rook agent will do the work to unmount, unmap, detach that device from the local node, and then the Rook agent running on this other node that the pod got moved to will do the same thing to, you know, map and attach the device and mount the same file system and to the pod. It has no idea that its data just moved across the cluster. It's still accessing the same data, and your MySQL database is still healthy. So right now, that's implemented as a flex volume in Kubernetes, which is being which is going the way of the buffalo and being replaced by a CSI in the future. We've got one of the guys, there's actually a couple of guys from Red Hat are working on that CSI driver, and they're going faster than I thought they were. So the CSI driver will be available pretty soon, which is a good step forward. And lastly, upgrades. Upgrades, stateful upgrades are easy. Stateful upgrades are hard. Because when you have a stateless upgrade and you've got no data, all you do is kill the thing and bring up the new version. Done, easy. But when you have data that needs to stay available, stay consistent, stay durable, that gets way harder, especially with Ceph, because Ceph, you know, has all these various components, monitors, OSDs, managers, RGW, MDS, all these components. So it's a very complicated system, and upgrading it is difficult. So we've been working kind of in baby steps of this for about a year now, where when you've got your full healthy Ceph cluster, you know, you upgrade, you update your cluster specification to say, give me a new version, and then the operator will take over and methodically go through the cluster and upgrade each component one at a time, make sure everything stays healthy, perform any migrations that it needs to go up to new schemas or new formats, and then move on to the next component. If anything goes wrong, then you know it will have to stop and try to roll back to a good known state. But basically, this is software automation that will handle upgrades of complicated systems. And it's really just another way that you know software automation is king. I mean, when you automate things, then you can start relying on them instead of having manual mistakes or having a human sitting there, you know, after midnight or 2 a.m. getting real tired and doing it manually. So automation is great. All right, so that's Ceph. So let's move on to a different topic now. So we're going to talk about what it takes if you have a storage solution to integrate in with Rook and bring that storage solution into Kubernetes so that pods and applications can start using that new storage. So the first thing to talk about is that you know, operators are pretty popular now. There's a lot of different operators that are out there for all sorts of different apps. And then and there's a couple of different ways to write them also. So when we started doing operators a year and a half ago or so, when it was kind of a new idea coming out of CoreOS, we wrote our own operator kit that kind of provides some of the Go code to register your custom resources, watch for events, and then call functions in response to that, like saying add cluster or delete cluster. So that's what the Rook project is still using to this day. But it's kind of out of date now. It hasn't really kept up with the times, and there's been efforts from other people to do way more with operators than what we were able to do, or we had time to do. So there's two things. The operator SDK came out of CoreOS and Red Hat and now IBM. And KubeBuilder is another really good one as well. They both kind of accomplish the same thing, that if you want to write an operator, you can use these projects to generate a whole bunch of that of your APIs and your reconciliation loops and your caches, your informers, your unit tests, your deployment. It's kind of amazing that those projects can do all that code for you as a developer. It makes you really productive, but it's also a little scary too that all that work is being done by other code now. And it's kind of like a glimpse of the future of automation coming for your job too. It's interesting. But it frees up time to work on more interesting stuff, I say. Okay, so let's talk about what it looks like to have Minio running in the cluster. So this is basically a custom resource definition, a CRD, that we tell, that teaches the Kubernetes API about what is Minio. Kubernetes has no idea what Minio is until we tell it, right? So this is basically saying, for this group Minio, there's gonna be something called an object store. And there's some extra metadata about it so that when I say object store on the command line, you know what I'm talking about now. And so this is an example of that, of once you've created the type, the custom resource, then you can create an instance of it and say, okay, give me an object store and I want it to be across four nodes. There's a lot of other configuration as well, but this is just a very small snippet. And this is kind of what the experience would be like. We'll do it in the demo too, where you create your type. You're saying, there's something called an object store. Now you know what it is. And then please give me an object store. And then now you can do a git on that and back and say that, okay, it's created. So this gets into a little bit more about you know, some of the more configuration options you can have as part of the Rook framework too. So this is a more fleshed out spec of what can go into a Minio object store. And so everything that's in the red box there is common stuff that can be used in any storage solution. Ceph uses it, Minio uses it, CockroachDB uses it, NFS uses it, Cassandra, all those guys are able to use these common sort of parameters for the scope of the storage boundaries in the cluster, how many resources to use, what networking configuration to use. And so the only thing in here that's specific to Minio is the credentials at the bottom. So that's kind of a way, it's trying to demonstrate here how Rook makes it easier for new storage solutions to, you know, integrate in with Rook and start, you know, running inside Kubernetes, because some of the work's already been done for you. The common stuff has been done for you. Minio has an operator just like Ceph. So basically this is just a deployment saying to, you know, run the Minio image inside of a deployment and run the operator. And so once that's up and running, it'll be there listening and waiting for for object stores to be requested and created. That image we just looked at is based on upstream Minio. So Rook is not in the business of rewriting the data path or writing data storage solutions ourselves. We're in the business of taking storage solutions, building on top all the orchestration and automation on top of it to make them run well and run easily inside of Kubernetes specifically. So we take upstream Minio, we add the Rook binary into it, and that's it, done. So I don't know, how many of you guys are developers that write Go code or any other languages? Are there many developers here? Okay, fair amount of hands. So this is what some of that Go code looks like, where you're saying for an object, a type that is an object store spec, I want a storage spec, a resource spec, and a network spec inside of it, and then those credentials that you saw earlier. So this is basically the Go representation of the YAML that we were looking at a couple slides ago. And this is some Go code here about saying when the Minio operator starts up, it's going to watch. It's going to start a watch for Minio instances to be created. And then we see right here is the key part where we have an add function, an update function, and a delete function of when the user says, I want to add a Minio object store to my cluster, then it'll run that function. Same with update and same with delete. And informers, we can kind of skip through this, but the important part about informers is that they're a very efficient way to get information from the Kubernetes API server, so you're not sitting there polling over and over to say, you know, give me the latest information. Okay, give me again. It basically keeps a local cache that it can read from locally to prevent burden of gets on the API server. If every single component inside Kubernetes did a get on the server whenever they needed information and didn't cache anything locally, the cluster would come to a halt. And this is the on-add handler we were talking about before, where inside of that function, that on-add, when a Minio object store gets included into the cluster, it'll run a few different functions to make the headless service for it, make the stateful sets, create a service on top of that. And this is all programmatic Go code that does all this work, talking to the Kubernetes API cluster to make a Minio object store happen. And similar for update, the body isn't here, but you know, in the update, you're going to look at the old one and then the new one and kind of do a diff, analyze the difference between the two, and then take corrective actions using the Kubernetes API to make the desired state become actual state. So I have a demo now here actually before the slide. So this is part of the... let's skip that and let's go to questions actually instead. So how to get involved? So as I mentioned, you know, Rook is an open source project. It's hosted by the CNCF. We have just over 100 different contributors now, people that have written code for the project, and we are always taking new contributors to write code for the project or to use the project, open GitHub issues, give us feedback. We love that stuff. So the more we can build that community, the happier we are. That's how we got to this project to where it is today, by people getting involved and people writing code and people using it. You can find us on Slack and on Twitter, the forums, and we have community meetings also. All right, so I'll open it for questions. We've got about 7 minutes for questions if anybody has any. Do you have a question? Yes. Do we have a microphone we can pass around too for questions? Sweet. Thank you. Here you go.
Yeah. In my understanding, the Rook is target for one-stop storage solution for all kinds of storage, right?
It's really an orchestrator, an integration point for a lot of storage solutions, yeah.
Yeah, and for right now, I don't know whether there's the roadmap to support, because for enterprise deployment, in the future, there may be require some authentication and authorization, or some advanced feature like encryption of the disk or the storage. Mm-hmm. And I don't know whether we have this kind of plan to support this. And the other question is that for storage-like stuff, because sometimes you need to do the scheduling. And is there any plan to have some kind of scheduling in Rook? Because for different storage, the scheduling might be different, right? So is there any kind of this framework or solution yet?
Yeah, those are really good questions, really informed questions as well. I'll take that from you. So to get to the first one, the enterprise features like encryption and reliability and all those sort of things that enterprises might rely on. So that really, a lot of those are going to come from the storage provider itself. So Ceph is a well-tested, battle-hardened storage solution that is used in a lot of massive production deployments. And it's got a lot of those features you're talking about, like encryption on the disks and all sorts of stuff like that. So you'll get a lot of those from the storage solutions themselves and not right out of Rook. You know, Rook is not on the data path. Rook is orchestrating the storage solution. Is it still on? No, I think it's still on.
Some feature like you have to, if a pod wants to mount a RBD, then he has to provide the keys or something like information like whether he can mount all this RBD or not, or provision an RBD or not, this kind of stuff.
Yeah, so that's there's a dynamic provisioner that gets the right keys and does that for you. There's a pull request right now actually that one of the maintainers is working on that will allow you to specify specific users that can access that storage to kind of start compartmentalizing based on user accounts. So there's more work to do there, I think. Especially in like a multi-tenant scenario, there's definitely more work to do there, I think. But I think that work is going to go into the CSI plugin and instead of what the existing Rook agent. So that work will be ongoing for sure.
The second question about scheduling.
Yeah, and so scheduling. I don't know if you're familiar with the special interest group, SIG Storage, Kubernetes SIG Storage, but there's a whole lot of work that's come out of there recently about topology aware scheduling that I think is reusable across a lot of storage solutions where if a pod has certain needs of certain type of data, that could be taken into account during scheduling time about where the pod is going to land in the cluster, depending on the underlying storage topology. So that's something that's coming out of SIG Storage, and I haven't gotten to use it myself yet, but it's my understanding that it's general and can be used with a lot of storage solutions, so we can integrate that in too.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. All right. Other questions? Oh, thank you.
Hey, great presentation. My question is that for Ceph, who is the scheduler for the OSD pod? My understanding is that the Rook will be the scheduler for the OSD pod.
Yeah, and that is correct. To get the OSD scheduled across the cluster, Rook does do that, and that's based on the user's request of they can specify how they want the OSDs to go out and be laid out along the cluster.
So would it be conflict with the KubeIS scheduler? For example, the node is less of CPU or memory, but has lots of free disk.
Yeah, that's a good question. The Kubernetes scheduler isn't really going to come into play there at all because the user says, on this node, I want you to use this disk, let's say, if they're being very specific. And then Rook will use pod annotations or pod labels to schedule it directly there and kind of basically bypass the scheduling algorithms.
Okay.
Yeah, so it'll not even come into play almost.
So would it cause problems if it bypasses the KubeIS scheduler?
It certainly could. That's definitely a way you could shoot yourself in the foot if you're putting something where it really shouldn't be running and you explicitly declaratively said put it there. We'll honor that, and you could get in a bad situation for sure. You could, yeah.
Yes, thank you.
I know I'm not perfect. I've shot myself in the foot many a times.
It is the operator that you talked about. Does it also do the Rook updates? I know operator takes care of a lot of things here.
Oh, to update the Rook software itself?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you have more question?
Just text sure. Engine. Does it take a backup of everything and then maybe upgrade to a newer version and then like snapshot or anything like that?
Yeah, that's a great question. And that gets into that that reliability of your day two operations and ongoing management of a cluster. There was a talk this morning about upgrading Kubernetes safely. That I don't know if anybody got to see it, but that has some, there's some great information and principles about upgrading in general. So for Rook specifically, you know, the operators in Rook will manage and upgrade the specific storage systems like CockroachDB or Ceph, right? But there isn't a meta operator on top of Rook to upgrade itself. And so but that's pretty simple though, because basically the Rook operator is running as a deployment. So what you do is you edit the deployment to say, okay, now use this version, and then that will use a rolling upgrade strategy, you know, the built-in Kubernetes upgrade algorithms to upgrade itself, you know, that way. And so there isn't support right now to do like taking a backup or a snapshot or making sure that everything can be restored if things go awry. And so that's something that we want to put into, you know, the next version of upgrade to kind of make it more robust. So we're still kind of building upgrade out right now, and there's more work to do there for sure. And that's a great example of a ways to harden it. Good question. I think we got one more, and then I think we're done after that, I think.
Well, thanks for the talk. Given that you are an open source project, I'm not sure if you have the answer, but do you know any enterprise that's using Rook in production?
Yeah, so I went through the exercise of doing the proposal to graduate Rook from the sandbox CNCF project to an incubating project. And part of that is you have to document production usage cases. And so that's all public on the CNCF's GitHub, you know, GitHub/CNCF. On there, there's the whole list of everybody who's using Rook in production.
Okay.
And, you know, some of them are had some fairly large deployments. But, you know, there's, we'll see more as we declare stable and move out of beta to stable at the end of this year. So there'll be more of them, but they're all documented on that site. And I'll try to send you a link. If you come find me, I'll point out to you.
Thank you.
All right, that's all the time we have. Thank you very much, guys. I appreciate it.